As our field looks to diversify its content and methodologies cross-culturally, music theorists are sure to encounter phenomena that resist Western musical intuitions. This paper deals with one such cross-cultural tension as it pertains to musical temporality in Sinitic opera. To get straight into the heart of the matter, let's listen to an excerpt from the Huangmei opera Tianxianpei. I invite you to conduct along with the excerpt to examine how you are personally orienting within the meter of this aria. Let's listen. You might have found this quite tricky to conduct, and that might be because the phenomenal accents in this aria do not recur in a regular pattern, even though each of the pulses are themselves durationally regular or isochronous. This phenomenon has been noted by other Sinitic opera scholars as well. Bao Yung, for example, rebars certain Cantonese opera arias in order to reflect the irregular strong and weak beat patterns that he hears in them. These examples reveal a mode of attending to musical temporality that competes with an important premise outlined in Johann Kirnberger's treatise. If one hears a succession of equal pulses that are repeated at the same time interval, experience teaches us that we immediately divide them metrically in our minds by arranging them in groups containing an equal number of pulses, and we do this in such a way that we put an accent on the first pulse of each group. This idea permeates many aspects of Western musical time, including the experience of time signatures, syncopations, groove, and hypermeter, each of which relies on a listener's ability to effortlessly anticipate the location of salient musical events based on the metric framework. Western music psychologists have even enshrined Kirnberger's idea as a fact of human hearing, calling the phenomenon subjective rhythmization. But the participant pools for these studies were limited to Western listeners, and the conclusions fail to meaningfully account for some aspects of the temporal experience of Sinitic opera, where the occurrence of accented or salient musical moments elude a periodic scheme and thereby elude a sense of metric anticipation. Instead, music like Tianxianpei invites us to adopt a different kind of embodiment, as Michael Tanzer would put it, or as Judith Becker has theorized, it invites us to be grounded within a different habitus of listening, that is, a set of culturally shaped aesthetic and syntactic expectations. This paper attempts to shed light on this way of embodying or inhabiting musical temporality by studying the sounds, theoretical constructs, and listener testimonies of two Sinitic opera types: Huangmei opera from Anhui province in China, and Goa opera from Taiwan. I'll attempt to move beyond the mere observation of temporal irregularities in order to analyze how these structures accrue aesthetic meaning within the local musical and philosophical imaginations. Let's begin by acquainting ourselves with a metric construct used in both Goa opera and Huangmei opera called Banyin. This device measures musical time in units of equal duration called ban and yin, which are grouped into cycles where ban is the first pulse of each cycle, while yin are the subsequent pulses.
Common ban-yin cycles include 1 ban 3 yin, 1 ban 1 yin, and ban without yin.
Contemporary musicians and scholars often explain ban-yin with reference to Western meters. For example, this Goa opera textbook depicts 1 ban 3 yin as 4-4 time, while 1 ban 1 yin is equated to 2-4 time. Despite their morphological similarities, there remain important perceptual and theoretical differences between ban-yin cycles and Western meters. Here's one crucial difference. Ban and yin pulses are played on different instruments, while no such timbral distinction is necessary in performing Western meters. By virtue of Banyan's timbral dimension, musicians can attune to the Banyan cycle even in the absence of a recurring accentual pattern. The Tianxianpei example that we heard from earlier demonstrates this. The excerpt is in one ban, one yin, as we can see from this score and simplified notation, where each bar line stands for the position of the ban.
Before we proceed further, let me give a quick intro on how to read simplified notation, which is a numbered notation with origins in France that is today widely used across Sinitic musical communities. Each number stands for a pitch in the relative do system, where 5 is sol, 6 is la, 1 is do, and so forth. A dot below the number indicates that the note is to be performed at the lower octave, while a dot above the number means that the note sounds at a higher octave. In Sinitic opera communities, this notation is usually sung using solfège. As for rhythms, adding one bar under a note makes it an eighth note, and adding two bars under a note makes it a 16th note. If you see no markings at all, that means it's a quarter note. An added dot to the side renders the note into a dotted value. Finally, adding a dash to the side makes the note a half note. Now then, let's listen to the Tianxianpei excerpt once more with the score.
If we home in on just the first phrase, we'll notice three iterations of a sol mi re melodic gesture. The high sol that it begins on is the second highest note of the excerpt, and it's also the modal tonic, so it's likely to be heard as a phenomenal accent. This is confirmed by how vocal coach Shi Yingyuan performs loud palm-facing claps at each of these high sol moments. Let's watch. Notice that the second high sol falls on a yin pulse, which results in Shi Yingyuan having to clap her palms twice in a row, breaking the patterned alternation between strong and weak claps. She also can be seen preparing that second palm stroke with a more exaggerated physical gesture, as if to caution her students to the presence of a syntactic disturbance. To my surprise, though, when I later asked Shi Yingyuan to introspect on her clapping pattern, her comments painted a different picture. Why do you clap your palm sometimes and then the back of your hand at other times instead of alternating consistently between the two? This has nothing to do with whether one claps the palm or the back of the hand. Do you clap your palm to prompt students to sing those moments with a bit more force? This has nothing to do with clapping. The clapping is just to beat out the rhythm. Because I wasn't able to glean a clear answer from this interview, I decided to ask another interlocutor, Shi Tianming, for his input. I don't understand why Shi Yingyuan claps her palms two times in a row. There's no difference between whether she claps the palm or the back of the hand. Despite my repeated probing into this matter, neither musician offered an explanation as to why the palm was clapped twice, and neither seemed to really understand the source of my curiosity. This suggests that they did not hear the moment as syntactically transgressive or otherwise worthy of discussion. In my work on Goa opera, I also encountered interlocutors who seemed similarly unfazed by the unpredictability of accent placements. In one exchange with Goa opera composer Cheng Mengliang, she explicitly claims that the bar lines of simplified notation are only meant to denote the location of the ban rather than to represent a strong metric position. She also maintained that musicians who are steeped in traditional practice wouldn't expect Goa opera melodies to emulate the kind of accentual hierarchies found in Western meters. In other words, concepts of Western meter might have been adopted for their perceived international prevalence, but they've been repurposed by local musicians to convey their own sensibilities for temporality, in which salient events can arise independently of rote cyclicity. The irregularity of accent placements also seems to spill over into the organization of phrase rhythms in Sinitic opera, as suggested in this interview with Huangwei opera artist Wang Xia. If you were in the middle of a phrase in a Huangwei opera work you hadn't heard before, would you have a feeling for when the next phrase should start? If it's an unfamiliar opera, unless it's an Erxing or Sanxing aria, there's absolutely no way to know what will happen next or when the next word will come. Phrase beginnings are difficult to anticipate because of the sheer diversity of phrase lengths found in Sinitic operas. For example, one archetypical Huangmei opera aria consists of a rising phrase of 6 bars, followed by a down phrase of 3 bars, an up phrase of 2 bars, and a falling phrase of 5 bars. Goa opera also features varied phrase lengths, which can result even in a shift in time signature when notated in simplified notation. Let's hear an example of this. Without prior familiarity with the conventions of phrase lengths in this aria, it would be difficult to intuit a sense of beginning, middle, and end from the phrase structure alone. What, then, grounds a listener's temporal experience if not metric anticipation? Well, based on my interviews, two forces come to light. First, the aestheticization of linguistic sound and syntax, and two, a philosophy of changeability. First, the expressive affordances of the text is of unparalleled importance in Sinitic opera, and its relationship to the music is often summarized with the phrase 以字行腔. That is, both the contours and the rhythms of the melody are thought to issue directly from the linguistic inflections of the spoken dialect. As Wang Xia notes, it, the phrase structure, is all simply to fit the words in. There's no real rule about placing words to create symmetries or fussing over whether a word should be placed slightly sooner or later. It's just to get the meaning across. Don't be so obsessively concerned about why this particular phrase came so quickly, while that phrase came so slowly. In the end, it is all about what is being emoted. Here, Wang Xia is indicating that her experience of temporality is fastened to the experience of the text, as if the expressive trajectory of the sung words are simply tugging the music along after it. The scholar Yi Fengling shares a similar perspective. Ban is not actually a marker of metric strength. Its ability to metrically constrain the melody has been weakened by the aesthetic sway of the sung text and the linguistic inflection. Therefore, it's more the tautness of the linguistic syntax rather than the metrical syntax that seems to be bestowing cohesiveness to the temporal experience. In addition to the shaping force of language, musical temporality seems to also flow out of the philosophies of change that are central to Sinitic thought. This can be observed in the way that Huangmei opera composer Wu Shuming talks about musical time. According to your habits of listening, this phrase and that phrase should be the same length. They should both be in 4/4 time, right? But rhythm is something of infinite changes, inexhaustible to the imagination. The phrase that Wu Shuming chooses to use, 千变万换, is imbued with resonances of a Taoist conception of the world, whereby all phenomena stem from the ever-changing and infinitely variable interactions of yin and yang. Within this cosmology, time markers such as seasons or time of day are also manifestations of the waxing and waning of yin and yang forces. Thus, time is significant insofar as it is a vessel for change, and conversely, time is virtually meaningless apart from the content that it conveys. As Liu Shuxian writes, the sort of abstractions employed in mathematics and the natural sciences in the West as applied to temporal sequences divorced from content, were alien to the Chinese tradition. A category of melody known as chuan conveyed this idea well. Chuan melodies are looped indefinitely during stage actions and can be concluded at nearly any point in the structure in order to coincide with the end of the sequence of actions. Goa opera composer Chen Xinghan describes chuan this way. In our understanding, we do not conceptualize chuan as consisting of a series of discrete phrases. Of course, upon close inspection, chuan can appear to exhibit discrete phrases, but we don't adopt this vantage point. Rather, we think of the entire chuan as one musical entity, meaning that musical phrases have the potential to happen anywhere. So you're saying that a new musical phrase could begin at any moment? Yes, and furthermore, a new musical phrase could end at any moment. Goa opera has many examples of this sort of phenomenon. Within this framework, temporal boundaries are not predetermined as being logical or syntactically appropriate. Instead, meaningful temporal units emerge by virtue of the stage actions that they frame, just as the structure of a synodic opera melody gains substance from the text that fills it. Having walked through these dimensions of the temporal experience in Huangmei opera and Goa opera, the final point I'd like to share is that these cross-cultural encounters can teach us more than just how to embody musical structures. They can also acquaint us with different modes of embodying the world at large. Kiernberger's quote conceptualizes time as something that can be apportioned into abstracted segments, and this in turn lends itself to an understanding of the natural world as an entity that can be artificially parceled up. Meanwhile, the irregularity of stresses and phrase lengths in synodic opera centers a different kind of worldview, one that rationalizes changeability, in which all things, people, and passing of events are ever in flux, endlessly variable, and thereby never fully graspable. Thank you.
This work is immensely indebted to my friends and interlocutors in Taiwan and Anhui. Not only do their marvelous insights serve as the cornerstone of this project, but they've also led me, over the years, to grow deeply in awe of my heritage, and that is something I will always be grateful for.